गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू द थर्ड लेक्चर ऑफ अर्थ एंड एनवायरनमेंट। कोर्स कोड इज GE27011। एज आई ऑलरेडी टोल्ड बिफोर, माई नेम इज़ डॉक्टर सुप्रिया फ्रेलाकम। आई एम एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सिविल इंजीनियरिंग इन BBT एंड ITM। नाउ लेट्स कम टू द स्लाइड्स। वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस ऑल ऑफ दिस। We have discussed till the abiotic structure, the chemical factors. Now let us come to the functional features of an ecosystem. Now the functional features of an ecosystem. So as we have already discussed the structural features of an ecosystem. Now coming on to the functional features of an ecosystem. The major functional features of an ecosystem are listed below. They are actually grouped into five categories. The first category is food chain, food web, and trophic structure. The second functional feature of an ecosystem is the energy flow. And the third functional feature is the cycling of nutrients, which is also called the biogeochemical cycle. The fourth is the primary and the secondary production. And the last and the fifth is ecosystem development and regulation. Now let us first discuss the first functional feature of an ecosystem. So the first functional feature of an ecosystem is the food chain, the food web, and the trophic structure. So the producers and the consumers are arranged in the ecosystem in a definite manner, and their interaction along with the population size is expressed together as trophic structure. So as we have already discussed, we have the arrangement of being, you know, being eaten and eating. So, and we have the producers which will be producing the food. So how the producers and how these consumers are arranged in the ecosystem, this is actually expressed in trophic structure. So the producers and consumers are arranged in an ecosystem in a definite manner, and their interaction along with population size is expressed together as trophic structure. As you can see in this diagram, in the diagram attached here, that first we have lots of vegetables and vegetables and grasses and all, which is the production, which is the primary producers. So this is the first trophic level. Then we have the second, which is the second trophic level, which is the first order consumers. Then we have the third trophic level, which is, you know, the bigger fishes. And on the top we have the fourth trophic level, that is the top predators. So each food level is known as the trophic level. So each food level, either it is a producer level or a consumer level, is known as a trophic level. And the amount of living matter at each trophic level at a given time is known as the standing crop or the standing biomass. Say for example, the amount is in the sense that how much of green vegetables or green plants are present. So that is will be one trophic level, and how much amount is present will be is the standing crop or the standing biomass. Now let us discuss a little more on what is food chain. Food chain is the sequence of eating and being eaten in an ecosystem. So in an ecosystem, we are alive because we are eating food, and that food comes through that food chain. So we as a human being, we are eating either vegetables, fruits, or we are eating, you know, fish, or we are eating meat. So the sequence at which this is eaten is called a food chain. Say for example, we have Say for example, we have the grasses, which is the producers. So actually they are the producers, and they are getting this energy from the sun. From sun they will get energy, and by using carbon dioxide and water they will do photosynthesis and produce more food. So this grasses can be eaten by a primary consumer like a grasshopper, and then this grasshopper can be eaten by a frog, and this frog can be finally eaten by a snake, and finally this snake can be eaten by a eagle or a hawk, which is the final consumer. Finally, when this hawk dies, they will disintegrate by the help of decomposers such as fungi. So this is the food chain. So who is eating what? So say for example, this is a grassland food chain example. We have the grasshopper, which is eating the grass as the first trophic level, and the frog, which is eating the grasshopper in the second trophic level, the snake or the hawk, which is eating the snake, which is eating the frog, is the third trophic level, and the hawk, which is eating the snake, as the fourth trophic level. Finally, the decomposers will decompose all of this. If grasshopper dies, then also it will be decomposing. If this hawk is also dying, they will also decompose. So this decomposers will consume the dead material of this, all of this trophic levels. So actually there are many types of food chain, but there are two major types of food chain. So these are called, the first one is called a grazing food chain, and second one is called a detritus food chain. In a grazing food chain, we have a starting point. Like something will be eaten by some animal or some plants or whatever this thing, some being. So in a grazing food chain, it starts with green plants and ends in a carnivores. Say for example, grass is being eaten by an antelope, which can be finally eaten by a lion. So it's starting with the green plant, which is the producer, and then finally it ends with the lion, which is the final consumer, which is a carnivore. Another example is the grass being eaten by a grasshopper, and then the grasshopper finally being eaten by frog, and then the frog being eaten by an eagle. So this is also a grazing food chain. So it starts with the grass and culminates with the carnivore, which is the eagle. The second type of a food chain is called a detritus food chain. It starts with dead organic matter, which the detritivores or the decomposers consume. So for example, in a forest we have dead leaves which is fallen down from the trees. This can be eaten by a wood louse, and with this wood louse may be eaten by a bird called a blackbird. Similarly we have other detritus food chains. So detritus food chains starts with a dead organic matter, like it may be a plant dead organic matter or an animal dead organic matter, which is being eaten by which the decomposers or detritivores consume. Now let us come to food web. So till now we have seen what is a food chain. Food chain is actually a chain where something is being eaten by something is being eaten and someone will eat it. So but in nature it is not always that easy. It is not always that simple. Say for example, we are thinking that the grass is being eaten by an antelope, then the antelope is being eaten by a lion. But the grass can be eaten by many other things. A grass can be eaten by a rabbit, the grass can be eaten by a grasshopper, so many things. So actually a food web is a network of food chains. So it's not always that simple. So a food web is a network of food chains where different types of organisms are connected at different trophic levels so that there are a number of options of eating and being eaten at trophic levels. So a grass also a food web is actually a more complicated type of food chain where we have many connections of like you that one particular thing may be eating many types of things. It's not that you are, for example, you also, you take yourself as example, you are not eating one thing, you eat many things. So you can eat vegetables, you can eat fruits, you can eat fish, you can eat animals. So it's not that it's not, everything is not as simple as a food chain. So a food web is a network of food chains where different types of organisms are connected at different trophic levels so that there are a number of options of being of eating and being eaten at its trophic level. Okay, see, let's take this example, the first diagram. So we have the plants, which is the first trophic level. They are, so this can be either eaten by a grasshopper or by a squirrel. The grasshopper can be eaten by a scorpion. A scorpion can be eaten by a fox. At the same time, this squirrel may be eaten by a fox and an eagle. So there are this squirrel has many, you know, it can be eaten by many types. So it's a food web. Similarly, in the second one, we have a very complex food web here. So in primary producers, we have the corn, the flowering plant, lavenders and mangoes, which can be eaten by grasshoppers. The corn may be eaten by grasshoppers. The flowering plants may be used by butterflies, and mangoes may be eaten by fruit fly, whose fruit fly may be eaten by a frog. This frog may consume both the grasshopper, the butterfly and the fruit fly, which may be consumed by a python. So actually, it's you can see from this, okay, it's not as in the nature, it's every, nothing is as simple as a simple food chain. All is actually a food web. Now, let's come to the significance of food chain and food web. Actually, food chains and food webs are actually very important from the point which we are going to discuss now. Energy flow and nutrient cycling in the ecosystem takes place due to food chain and food web. So whatever energy and nutrients we are eating, we are getting it from food chain or food webs. So we are getting energy from either primary producers. From that primary producers, we are getting that energy, but we may get that energy either through some fish or some, you know, directly from the primary producers. So at the same time, we are also using nutrients, and when we die, that nutrients is finally going to go back to earth or to the soil. So this energy flow and nutrient cycling in ecosystems takes place due to food chain and food webs. Food chains help in maintaining and regulating the population size of different animals and thus help maintain the ecological balance. So food chain is actually very very important. So it helps in maintaining population size. For example, if we have a forest and this forest has lots of grasses which is being eaten by, say, for example, an antelope or a deer, and if their population is not controlled by being eaten by a lion or a tiger, the population may increase in such a manner that it will be not feasible. So this process of being eaten and eating is actually very important in regulating the population size. So if no one is eating the deer or antelope then it will be very, very the population of that deer or antelope may increase to such a level that it may not be feasible. So in that case, so it's very important. So being eaten is actually also very important. food chain is also actually very important from a new point of view, a new word we are going to use. Food chain shows biological magnification or biological biomagnification of some chemicals. So food chain is showing some a term called biological magnification or biomagnification. So what exactly is biomagnification? Biomagnification is a phenomenon in which some non-biodegradable chemical like pesticides, heavy metals, etc. are passed from one trophic level to another, with the concentration increasing at each successive level, successive trophic level. Thus, animals occupying higher trophic levels are at a greater risk of biomagnification or toxic chemicals. Okay, let me read it once again. Biomagnification is the phenomenon in which some non-biodegradable chemicals like pesticides and heavy metals are passed from one trophic level to the another, with the concentration increasing at each successive trophic level. Thus, animals occupying higher trophic levels are at a greater risk of biomagnification of toxic chemicals. So let me explain this biomagnification, for example, by giving a small example. As you can see from this diagram here, we have the first level. In the first level, we have phytoplanktons, then we have shrimp, and then we have a small fish called a white croaker, and then we have salmon, and then finally, the salmon is being eaten by humans, human beings. So, take for example that we have a small lake in which this phytoplankton. So let's take that lake as an ecosystem here. So that phytoplankton are being grown in this lake. So if you put in a small heavy metal like a cadmium, say for example, if cadmium somehow reaches that lake as a, you know, because we have lots of pollution and all, it reaches the lakes and it gets dissolved in the lake water. So that phytoplankton is going to assimilate that cadmium. So cadmium is a toxic heavy metal and it is a very poisonous. So since this phytoplanktons, we are using phytoplanktons. Okay, so imagine that one phytoplankton is taking one, say for example, I'm using a very simple example here. So let's say that one phytoplankton has one cadmium atom. Imagine. So let's take this for example. Say one phytoplankton is assimilating one cadmium atom. So now when this shrimp eats this phytoplankton, imagine that one shrimp is having 100 phytoplankton. So one shrimp is eating 100 phytoplankton. So one phytoplankton had one cadmium. So when this shrimp has 100 phytoplankton, this shrimp is going to have 100 cadmium. So one shrimp will have 100 cadmium atoms. So the concentration is increasing. Okay, now imagine that this white croaker is having 10 shrimp in one day. 10 shrimp, say for example, it's in its lifetime, say. So now we'll have 10 shrimp in the sense, how many phytoplankton, how many cadmium this white croaker will be having? So 100, so phytoplankton had 1, and then shrimp had 100, and then white croaker will have 100 into 10, so 1000. Similarly, if the salmon is eating 10 white croaker, say for example, then it will have again 100, one phytoplankton, then 100, and then 100 for phytoplankton, 100 cadmium for shrimps, and then 1000, and then 1000 into 10 again, so 10,000. Say if that person, if a human being has, say for example, in his lifetime, say we have 10 salmons, then how much of concentration of cadmium we'll be having, imagine. So we'll have 10,000 into 10, so we'll have 100,000, so we'll be 1 lakh. So 1 lakh cadmium, this is simply an example to show that how the concentration of cadmium is being increased at its trophic level. So from 1 we had 100, and 100 and we will have 1000, and 1000 then we have 10,000, and 10,000 we have 1 lakh. So this is how the concentration is increasing. So at the water level, at the pond level, this the concentration of cadmium may be less, but when we as a human being, we eat fish or something like that, or some other animals, that concentration of the pesticide or the non-biodegradable chemical, will the concentration will increase to such a level that it may be very toxic for us. So again, bioidentification is the phenomenon in which some non-biodegradable chemicals such as pesticides are passed from one trophic level to the another, with the concentration increasing at X successive trophic level. Thus, animals occupying higher trophic level are at a greater risk of biomodification of toxic chemicals. So, since we as human beings are at the topmost trophic level, we are at the very high risk. Now, let us come to the ecological pyramid. So, ecological pyramid, so I hope you understood biomodification. Now let's come to ecological pyramid. Ecological pyramid is the graphical representation of trophic structure and functions of an ecosystem, starting with the producers at the base and successive trophic levels forming the apex. So it's a graphical representation. So it's actually a pyramid. So this is actually in the form of generally a pyramid. So pyramid in the sense, it will be, most of the time it will be brought at the base and and it will be thinner as we go up. So, but this is actually, it's not always looks like a pyramid, but most of the time it looks like a pyramid. So ecological pyramid is a graphical representation of trophic structures. So at one level we will have one trophic structure, and then the next trophic structure, like that. And function of ecosystem, starting with the producers at the base and successive trophic levels forming the apex. So ecological pyramids are of three types. There are actually three types of ecological pyramids, or as you can say, three ways by which we can represent trophic structure. The first one is called the pyramid of number, the second one is called a pyramid of biomass, and the third one is called a pyramid of energy. So as you can see that in the trophic the ecological pyramid, in the first trophic level we'll have producers, and then we'll have herbivores, like then we'll have carnivores, and then we'll have the secondary carnivores, and then at the same time we'll have the apex, the predators. Now let us first discuss pyramid of numbers. Pyramid of numbers, actually this is all very easy. So pyramid of numbers actually represents the number of individuals at its trophic level. So it will give the number of individuals. Say for example, and it may be upright or inverted. It may be upright like the figure here, as you can see on this thing. Second. It may be upright like this, or it may be inverted like this. So, so it is actually in the pyramid of numbers, you count the number of individuals or animals or plants. So, for example, in here we have the producers. So this is the producer. So this is a number. So for example, if we have how many green grasses we are having. So then we'll have the primary consumers that will give the how many, say for example, rabbits will be there. Then the secondary consumers, say for example, how many, say anything, how many foxes or something which will eat, the numbers. This is just the number, okay? So take this for example, this will actually, so here in this, the producer. So how many grasses will be there? How many grass, so if for example, we have, may have thousands or 1 lakh grass plants. And then we'll have the second plant will be the insect. How many insects? So the number of grasses will be, in a forest we'll have lots of grasses. So the number of grasses will be more. So how many, so numbers, say for example 1 lakh. So insect, for example, we'll have, say for example, we'll have 10,000 insects. And then say frogs. The number of frogs or birds will be lesser than the number of the insects. So say for example thousands. And then the hawks and birds, it will be lesser. So this will be the top carnivores. Similarly, but it may also be inverted. Inverted in the sense that, say for example, in a if we take a forest, the number of trees will be lesser. The number of grasses will be more, but the number of trees will be lesser. The number of birds, which will be dependent on the trees, will be more than the trees. So this is a number. So if we have, say for example, 1,000 trees, the birds will be like 10,000. So, and then we'll have this lice and bugs, which will be, you know, sort of like eating, sucking blood from the birds. The numbers will be more. So we'll have more numbers of lice and bugs. And then finally, these hyperparasites will feed on this lice and fleas, this microbes, the numbers will be lesser. So see, here we have the upright pyramid of numbers, and then this is the inverted pyramid of numbers. So in the pyramid of numbers, you count the number of individuals at one trophic level, the number, so number of grasses, number of birds, and number of trees, okay? Now coming on the second one, the pyramid of biomass. So in the pyramid of biomass, it is based on the total number, the total biomass or the dry matter at its trophic level in the food chain. So total biomass in the sense, for example, if we, let's take this example, okay? So this may also be upright or inverted. Say, for example, when you count here, in this is an upright pyramid of biomass. So in the total, so we'll have the first one, the number of, so the amount of, this is the biomass. It's actually, so biomass in the sense when we dry it. So the weight, the how much mass of grass will be there. We'll have in a forest, for example, if you take in a forest, the amount of grass will be huge. So you can measure the amount of grass by, you know, weighing it, even if you want. Say for example, it may be, let's take this example. Say we have in a small forest, we have 10,000 kgs of grass, okay? So the pyramid of biomass is through the biomass or total dry mass. And then in the second phase, we'll have second trophic level, we'll have a rabbit. Say for example, we have many rabbits, but then their weight is comparatively not at this much. So for example, if this has 10,000, this will have, say for example, 100. And then we'll have foxes, which will be lesser numbers, and obviously less, since it is lesser number and says lesser, so lesser biomass. And then finally we'll have the hawk, which will be again, which the biomass will be lesser. At the same time, we may have inverted biomass here. Say in an lake, in a pond or lake ecosystem, we'll have phytoplanktons, okay? It may look like a huge, but when you finally dry this phytoplankton and weigh it, the amount of the weight will be very less. Okay, so the amount of biomass or dry matter of phytoplankton present is less. Then we'll have the zooplanktons, the amount will be more better. more than this, and then finally we'll have small fishes. Small fishes, if we take this and weigh them, the biomass will be bigger, and then finally we'll have the large fishes. Even though this large fishes with the numbers may be comparatively lesser, but then the biomass, when we finally weigh it, it will be higher. So pyramid of biomass is actually based on the total amount of the total biomass at its trophic level. Then finally, let's come to the most important part of the pyramid. This is called the pyramid of energy. This is based on the amount of energy present, actually. So it's based on the amount of energy present. So, and this gives the best representation of trophic relationship, and it is always upright. So others may have been upright or inverted, but in the pyramid of energy, this already is always upright. In the sense, more energy at the initial level, at the first trophic level, and then this will keep on decreasing. So we'll finally have something like a pyramid. So pyramid of energy is based on the amount of energy present at its trophic level. The amount of energy present at its trophic level is always, it's actually more at the base, and it will keep on decreasing as we go up. So this gives the best representation of trophic relationship, and is always upright. So at X successive trophic level, say for example, at this trophic level and then compared to this, there is a huge loss of energy, about 90%, in the form of heat respiration. Thus, at each next higher level, only 10% of the energy passes on. Hence, there is a sharp decline in the energy level of its successive trophic level as we move from producers to crop carnivores. Say for example, in the first time, see, we have this much. We have 1 million joules of sunlight. Okay, this 1 million joules of sunlight, which will be used by the plants to generate 10,000 joules of energy. Finally, when this is eaten by our primary consumers, this will come to 1,000, and then to 100, and finally when it reaches a top carnivore like a fox, it will have only 10 joules. So to fox to get energy, he has to eat, so he has to consume lots of energy is required. So at its successive trophic level, there's a huge loss of energy, that is around 90%. So because say for example, for the plants to grow, it is going to use heat, and it is going to respire. So that particular, for maintaining itself, this plants also require lots of energy. So for each trophic level, another around only 10% of the energy passes on, and hence there is a sharp decline in energy level of each successive trophic level as we move from producers to carnivores. So most of the time when we use the pyramids, the pyramid of energy it gives the best representation of trophic relationship. So we should always try to use this pyramid of energy. Now this next slide is actually I wanted to compare all the three, the pyramid of numbers, pyramid of biomass, and pyramid of energy. So in the numbers, say for example, we have this same thing. We have an oak tree here, then we have caterpillars, then we have this animal, and then we have a sparrowhawk. So numbers, so when you count numbers, number of oak tree will be very less. Say for example, in a forest we have 100 oak tree, then caterpillars will be, lots of caterpillars will be there. So for example, it may be 1 lakh. And then we have this animal, and then this. But when you come to biomass, even though the number of oak tree will be less, say for example 100, say, but when you count the biomass, when you finally weigh it, the biomass will be actually very high. Similarly, caterpillar, even though the number is less, the biomass will be lesser. similarly here and similarly here. And then when energy, as we told, energy is always upright, the oak tree will be having lots of using lots of energy. Finally, when it transfers that energy to the caterpillar, it will keep on decreasing. So this is how the pyramid of number, biomass and energy looks for us, you know, for a particular group of animals. Now let us finish this class here, and I hope you will study till here. I hope you understood what I try to say. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Let's continue the class next time. Okay, thank you.